to do. There's two things we do in this state. It's over a big mission, but two parts of that mission. One of them is affecting public policy directly by talking with legislators, introducing bills that limit government, and destroying bills that increase the size of government. And then on the other side, what we try to do is educate the hearts and minds of Oregonians on the merits of individual rights and limited government. Now that's through publications and things like the Oregonian, the Roseburg Beacon, being on TV, being on radio, but we feel that there's two parts to putting the state on the right path. One affecting public policy directly, and the other one changing the range of views on the proper role of government within this state. We've been working for 20 years at it, and obviously we need at least 20 more. Now, I was asked to talk here today about renewable energy, and I want to cover a few things. Now, before I start, I want to let you know that part of Cascade's mission is talking with these legislators, and we hold these things called legislative leadership forums. It's not an oxymoron. There are some folks down there that are good leaders. And what we do is we put on presentations on, I would say, public policy topics that are relevant to the legislative session. Now, I did this exact presentation, except for one slide difference. And as I go through, I'm going to tell you the one that I did not show to legislators and the reason why. But I gave this exact same one to about 40 legislators and their aides when the session began. And hopefully it informed them on some of the issues of renewable energy, energy generation in the state, and some of the plights we're going to see coming up in the next decade. So I want to cover a few things. Now I'm going to go quick through this, but if you ask me afterwards, I can shoot you the PowerPoint presentation via email afterwards, so you don't have to necessarily write anything down. Just get my card and I'll send it off to you. I want to cover the status of renewable energy in this state and energy in general, some of the economic costs of the public policies already in place, and then I want to give you the freedom perspective, something kind of happy to leave you on. Now, if we're talking about electricity generation in the state, if you count hydroelectricity as renewable energy, we're about 63% renewable energy in the state. Now, in contrast, as a nation as a whole, the nation as a whole is about 8%. We're at 63%. A lot of nice, clean, renewable electricity from our hydroelectric dams and the Columbia River system. Now, generation is slightly different than consumption because we're in a regional market. We import electricity from other states, surrounding states, coal power, the works. But even so, and these figures are a little old, they came from the Oregon Department of Energy. It takes them apparently about 8 years to get data in. We're probably about 55% renewable energy counting hydroelectricity as part of that. Now, I'd like to give some real positive things for legislators down there. There were some Democrats in this room when I gave this presentation, as well as Republicans and their aides. And I like to give these positive stats, so you know, you kind of build them up here. Now, Oregon is currently ranked 48 out of 50 states in carbon intensity. That's the amount of carbon dioxide emissions per unit of electricity generated. Now, I know folks in this room, including myself, are not worried about carbon dioxide emissions. However, there are some folks in the state that are. And we're doing really, really well. But now let's talk about real pollutants. I know the EPA considers carbon dioxide a pollutant. I do not. But there are real pollutants. Sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxide, which were 46th and 48th of the entire United States on those. We're doing really well. Why are we doing so well? Because of our reliance on hydroelectricity. Clean, renewable hydroelectricity. So the Energy Information Administration, federal government, statistical arm of the federal government and energy, classifies hydroelectricity as renewable energy. And because of that, we're third out of the entire nation on generation and capacity of renewable energy. However, Oregon legislators decided that hydroelectricity shouldn't count as renewable energy. And apparently water falling over a dam isn't considered renewable. And in 2007, they passed a bill, Senate Bill 838, and yes, there was even Republican sponsors of this bill, Senator Jason Atkinson, I didn't say that. And it passed Senate Bill 838, which moves Oregon in a specific direction as far as generating electricity is concerned. What it did is it forced our major utilities, PGE, Pacific Power, and the minor utilities to some degree, to procure a certain amount of renewable energy, other than hydroelectricity, by a certain year. Now it's 25% renewable energy by 2025. Now, if you say 25% renewable energy by 2025, I just saw those slides. We were at 63, 55%, somewhere around there. Well, yes, we would have already reached the goals if we included hydroelectricity in that. But since we didn't, we have to reach them now. And it set a specific definition of renewable, kind of a politically preferred definition of renewable, which makes this really truly a wind energy mandate. And that's why we're seeing all these wind turbines going up in eastern Oregon, and you know, wind turbine blades going out on I-84, and all sorts of issues with Bonneville Power Administration. So really what we're seeing here is that the vast majority of renewable electricity in our hydroelectricity system does not count as renewable, and we have a wind mandate to reach 25% renewable energy by 2025. But it's not just Senate Bill 838. It's not just these renewable portfolio standards, these renewable energy mandates. Now, of course, on the federal level, they're talking about it as well. It's called a clean energy standard, kind of a happy name to it. But also, we banned nuclear power in 1980. It's been banned since 1980 until we have a federal storage facility for nuclear waste. It's not going to happen. Passed in 2009, a bill that Cascade Policy Institute fought pretty vehemently. We have banned coal power in this state. We'll never build another coal plant in this state as long as this bill is still in effect. And also, it ends future contracts with coal plants, so we'll not be able to buy coal power in the future either. Large-scale hydroelectricity doesn't count towards those renewable portfolio standards, and it's largely tapped out in the Pacific Northwest. We're not building any larger dams. In fact, right now, we're pulling dams out of rivers. And this is something that's really interesting, and I caught some legislators off guard with this one. No one really knows this, even legislators, but we passed a carbon tax in 1997, the first one in the entire nation that affects natural gas generation facilities and a few other types of facilities as well. And it increases the price of natural gas electricity in this state. So the electricity we get derived from natural gas, clean burning natural gas, is higher than it would be otherwise because we have a $1 million tax on it. When a developer wants to create a natural gas facility, he has to pay anywhere between $2 to $10 million to an organization called the Climate Trust, who then spends the money on carbon offsets around the world, including places like Ecuador. So that increases the price of natural gas. Now this is a big chart and it looks confusing and everything, and I don't even need you to look at all this stuff. Really what this is, it's the levelized cost of different energy sources. Now levelized is a kind of a cost comparison between the capital cost of construction, operating and maintenance costs, and decommissioning of a power plant costs. It includes every cost associated with it. So if a legislator or one of those folks from Green Mountain Energy outside of your grocery store says wind energy is cheap because wind is free, he's wrong, and you can tell him that you saw the facts because of that. Now what this shows is from here down, and I know some of you folks in the back can't see it, biomass, geothermal, solar thermal, solar PV, wind, are considered renewable energy according to the strict definition of our renewable energy mandates. Above is not. But we have those other bans in the state or regulations. Coal, you can strike that off the list. We're not able to use that in the state. Natural gas is more expensive in our state. Nuclear, we can't have it, and hydro is not counted as renewable energy. So these numbers down here, the final figures over there, are significantly higher costs of energy versus what we could have produced if we didn't have these restrictions. So what we're doing is we are forcing more expensive energy onto the grid system. That's what these mandates and restrictions are doing. Now, when I say that, a lot of legislators will say, well, we can make up a lot of this with energy efficiency. If we can just put more money into energy efficiency and conservation. Yes, it can subtract some of the demand for energy in some sense, but we have to realize the reality of the day is that Oregon is growing in population. It continues to grow because of people like me. Don't hold it against me. I moved up from California. And also, new Oregonians are being born every day. In fact, energy consumption has increased 133% in the last 40 years, and the Oregon population is expected to grow about 30% up to 2025 when we're supposed to meet those mandates. And because of these increases in population, we're going to have to see increases in energy sources to meet the energy demand of the future. So what are we building? What are we building to anticipate this growth? We're building wind. That's pretty much what we're building. An additional 2,189 megawatts, that's a unit of energy, a large amount of energy, is going onto the grid in the next few years. And 77% of that is made up of wind. Natural gas makes up the remainder for the most part. Two energy sources, putting all our energy eggs into one basket pretty much. 77% of wind energy. Now, before I go on and talk about the economic costs and depress you a little bit, I'll depress you with this fact. Now, I bring this up because I think this is important. It brings that emotional aspect into talking about renewable energy, generally a dry subject. 1 in 20 Oregonians had their electricity shut off due to inability to pay in 2008. Now, that number has stayed fairly constant today, but the numbers on the low-income assistance programs on your bills has gone through the roof. In fact, 1 in 4 Oregonians are now past due on their electricity bill accounts. Now, what I show this for is it shows the plight of Oregonians in being able to pay their bills. A lot of this is ultimately due to the recession, people losing their jobs. But electricity prices are increasing, and as we see those increase, we're going to see these numbers increase as well. Now, some folks will say, well, I can pay my electricity bill, it's okay. But when someone doesn't pay their bill, that cost is socialized into the rate structure and you end up paying for them. So when others can't pay for their electricity, you end up paying for it. So because of this, because we saw electric utilities being painted into this corner on what kind of energy they can provide for Oregonians, Cascade Policy Institute decided to commission an economic study to see how this was going to affect us in the next 10 years. Kind of a launching pad for having a discussion with legislators, an adult conversation with legislators on what to do about fixing this situation. So we hired some economists, actually happen to be friends of mine, out of Beacon Hill Institute at Suffolk University in Massachusetts to assess this. Now, I like this slide, and I'm going to tell you why I like this next one. Because don't you remember the Obamacare health thing? Don't you remember that, where it was like all those different things? Well, that's kind of what this looks like. But really what this is showing is the model we use is a dynamic model, which means it assesses all the changes in markets and prices, and it assesses net effects. So if there's job gains from these green jobs that everybody keeps talking about, we assess that, but we also assess job losses and we tell you the net, okay? And that's really what this is showing, but it's complicated and I like it because it compared it to the Obamacare thing. So electricity cost increases. Now, a lot of the effects are really going to hit us in 2015. Now, we've already seen some electricity cost increases. I believe we're all PGE customers in here. We saw a 4.2% increase as of January 1st, but if you noticed, if you pay attention, which I do because I'm a stickler, on the back of your bill, the renewable energy cost adjustment, did you see that? Well, it adds a few dollars extra per electricity bill, and that goes directly to because of renewable energy mandates on the state level. And they need to pay for it, so they're extracting it out of you. So between 2015 and 2025, an average Oregonian household is going to spend an additional, above and beyond, $1,700 on electricity. But a commercial business that uses more energy in their operations, obviously, is going to spend about $9,600 more, and industrial about $80,000 extra over that time period. Now, the overall cost of the renewable portfolio standards, these renewable energy mandates forcing you to purchase renewable electricity, between 2015 to 2025, about $6.8 billion over conventional power, within a range of $4 to $9.3 billion. Also, economic cost. Now, this is in by 2025, when these mandates are supposed to be met. Annual investment is going to fall by $145 million, up to $204. Annual real disposable income, the money you have left over, which isn't much after taxes and paying your bills, is going to fall by $170 million, all the way up to $230 million. And breaking it down to the household level, Oregon families are going to spend an additional, above and beyond any other price increases, $250 per year more for electricity costs.
Are those today's dollars?
Those are today's dollars. Commercial businesses, an average of $1,400, and industrial businesses, $11,500 more per year. Now, speaking of this job losses, with the net job losses, by 2025, the Oregon economy is expected to lose an average of 17,500 jobs. Now, how does this happen? With Obama preaching that we were going to, you know, increase, rejuvenate our economy with green jobs. Now, it's interesting because I always kind of laugh at that. My background is in economics. I got my education in economics, and I always kind of chuckle at that concept of we are touting an industry by the amount of jobs it needs to create something, right? So break this down on kind of a more personal level here. Let's say you run a hamburger store, a hamburger, McDonald's or something, and you start bragging that your store takes 30 people to create one hamburger. The guy down the street says, oh no, I can do better than you. I can have 50 people creating one hamburger. So it's funny when we say that we want to increase the amount of labor inputs to produce a product. And by that same logic, that I suppose we could probably increase a lot of jobs in this state by paying people to turn the wind turbines when the wind stops blowing.
Good idea.
But the low-cost scenario says 10,000, the high-cost scenario, 24,000 jobs lost because of these policies. Now, when I say this, there's still people that say, Todd, you're wrong, you didn't hire economists, you hired clowns over there. But we happen to have a couple case studies right here in the state that show exactly what I was saying. Now, the Portland goal, they set the city of Portland under the fantastic leadership of Mayor Vera Katz, back in 2001, decided to pass a renewable energy goal where all state agencies and or city agencies and city offices had to rely on 100% renewable energy by 2010. Well, it's 2010 and it's come and gone and they are approximately at 9%. Okay, now the Oregon goal, let's move on to that because that's even a funnier one. I got a kick out of this one because Governor Kulongoski was leaving a green legacy, so apparently. And in 2005, Governor Kay decided that he was gonna impose a similar goal on the state. All state agencies, all state offices, 25% renewable energy by 2010. Well, that seems 25%, that's okay. Well, 2 years later, completely unfazed by that goal, he increased it, 2007, he increased it to 100% renewable energy by 2010. Waved a magic wand and expected it to happen. Well, 2010 has come and gone, and you're at 1%. Now, let's see what the excuse is for that. I'm sure they had some sort of excuse when I called them up and, you know, asked them, hey, what happened? Well, a Portland city official said the goals were unattainable due to a need to balance desire for clean energy and fiscal responsibility. Now, I didn't think many city officials actually knew those two words. But you know, that's what he says. And then in Oregon, I talked to the governor's communications director, and, you know, she said a lot of things offline to me, but this is what she said according to the record. Economic challenges played a large role in meeting this goal. Okay, so the city and the state have decided that it's too expensive. It's unrealistic to achieve these goals. It puts a burden on taxpayers. But for some reason, they still want to force all of us in the room to do exactly what they failed at achieving. So what have we found? We found that restrictive energy policies, not only renewable energy mandates, take away choice and freedom from all of us. They also led to an artificial increase in renewable energy, wind turbines popping up all over eastern Oregon. And because of that increase, we're seeing higher electricity costs, and we're gonna see higher electricity costs in the future. Now, Cascade solution, freedom and less government. Now, I'm guessing this room likes those two solutions because ultimately that's a solution to most problems, and most problems are government created. So we wanna repeal restrictive energy policies that force renewable energy. Now I say this is my goal, it's my dream, I'd love this. But ultimately we have to work on incremental steps towards reforming it first because the political awareness or ability is not there yet. However, renewable energy can and should expand according to a voluntary demand. Now this seems like it's a novel concept to some folks. I laugh at the guy who drives around in a smart car. I do. I kind of chuckle. I say I can't fit my right leg into that car. Okay, I do. I chuckle about it. But then again, I also chuckle at the guy who drives a Hummer because I say, man, I could never afford the gas for that vehicle. That seems dumb too. But you know what's great about this country? Both of those people can choose what they want to drive, and that is a wonderful thing.
Absolutely.
Now the same thing goes for renewable electricity. Now, we can allow ratepayers, electricity consumers, to pay for the higher cost of renewable energy if they value and they can afford it. So what does that do? It protects ratepayer choice and personal freedoms and lowers the financial burden on the rest of us who don't value or can't afford it. Now, this is the slide I took out for legislators. Now, Patrick Sheehan, he isn't in the room, is he?
No,
okay. Okay, but either way, I don't think he'd take this one up. He's a good guy. I took this one out because oftentimes I bring up these analogies and then some legislators like, wow, that's a great idea, we should do that. So here's the thing. Now picture this, you go into your grocery store, you line up, you got all your groceries, you're going in the checkout stand, and the lady says, you're gonna have to go to the back of the line. Oh, why? Well, you didn't purchase 25% of your groceries from organic sources. And a recently passed mandate forces you to purchase 25% from organic sources because it's good for the planet. Well, we don't do that right now. Why don't we do it? Because it's ludicrous. It's crazy. Some people can't afford organic food. Some people don't value some of the perceived benefits, health benefits, environmental benefits of organic food. We don't do that. For some reason, we have allowed it to happen in our electricity market. Some reason. Now, I didn't want to do this because I could see a bill coming up, Senate Bill, you know, 101 or something coming up, and they're going to say, yeah, now we're going to mandate people to buy organic food. So I pulled this one out so they wouldn't get any ideas. But what we see here is, and this is old data as well, mainly because this is part of a, I think a government project of some sort. But the data is from 2006, but it shows year after year, most of these utilities increasing in their voluntary programs for renewable energy. In fact, Portland, I guess the beacon of green in the United States, is at 10%, the highest in participation rate in the nation. So when people say, well, where should renewable energy be at in Portland? 10%. Is that a novel concept? People want renewable energy. You get it. That's how it works. Same thing with organic food, which has done great without subsidies, handouts, mandates, or anything like that. So, I also pulled these ones out because the legislators don't need to see this one, so I kind of lied earlier. But after I give these presentations, I usually end right there and everybody's like, well, what are you doing about it, Todd? You know, you just told us a bunch of information, but you know, what are you guys doing about it? So I've decided to change that and add a couple slides just to show you how we're changing this and working towards it, and also how you can help me, because ultimately that's why I'm here, just so you can help me. I'm self-interested, I guess. So we're freedom lobbyists. Now, if you don't like that word lobbyist, you get kind of disgusted by it, then you just say freedom consultant. We work directly with legislators to introduce bills to repeal reform restrictive energy policies. We had a number this session. In fact, there was even a bill, surprisingly enough, to consider hydroelectricity as renewable energy. It was an interesting hearing. It didn't get past committee, but it was an interesting hearing. And there's a number, and we actually have a number in the future as well to reform these restrictive energy policies. But also, we're media gurus all over the place. You pick up that Northwest Connection, I think half of it is Cascade Policy Institute. And that's because we publish things so that we can educate, inform the citizenry so you can hold your political leaders accountable, whether that be on the city council, all the way up to the state level, all the way up to the federal level as well. And we're speakers, educators, and presenters. That's me right now. And we come out to groups like this mainly because not only do I love a refreshing time being with other limited government folks, not dealing with the big government folks in Salem and needing a few beers after I leave that town, but I do it because ultimately I want to provide you folks with the intellectual ammunition so you can fight the battles. You guys are the foot soldiers. You guys are doing great things in this state. This group is fantastic. It's grown so much you've moved out of the Harley place and moved to this extremely safe location. So that's what we do. Now, how can you guys help? Well, the first one you guys have already done, join a grassroots organization to get involved and build a team. But also you want to inform your neighbors, your friends, your relatives, everyone you can to put this state on the right path. Spread the word about what you heard and what you're going to hear in the future at these meetings. Also contact your legislator. Now, I don't have any children yet, but when I do, I'm using this as the analogy, if I send them to public school, they're going to know me by name. And their eyes are going to twitch when I walk into the room. I want you guys to be like that with your legislator. Now, you know, Representative Sheehan's eyes don't need to twitch when you walk in. He should smile when you guys walk in, but he should know your name. You should be able to make an appointment, make a phone call, send an email. If you don't do that throughout the year, you're not having that much influence, and that's unfortunate. And then the last thing here, this is going to be a really cheap plug. Cascade Policy Institute is an IRS-certified C3 organization. We rely on individual donations from generous folks around the state to do our operations and send me out to locations like this. support your local freedom organization.
All right.
And that's it. I'll take questions if we have a minute, maybe a minute or two. I know we're kind of behind, but maybe a minute or two. Biggest hand in the back there.
I'm a landlord. I had a tenant recently have a problem with a hot water leak under a house. And it resulted in a massive amount of water wasted and a massive amount of natural gas from hot water heater. I called the city of Sherwood and said, we'll help out. It's a hardship situation. We're going to cut the wasted water in half and build a building for half the waste. I called Northwest Natural, same scenario. You know, we're sorry. We don't do such things. My question, PGE and Northwest Natural Gas are forever showing up, their little emblems, supporting all sorts of political causes, left-wing, Democrat things, and of course, green energy. They're a phone answering device. Yes, sign up for this. They don't care because they're a monopoly granted by government politicians who are guaranteeing them a profit. Yeah. Is there anything in that arena to do something about that and break that tie?
You know, it's difficult because I work in a market, in the energy policy market, that is the most regulated market in the United States. Electric utilities are not corporations. They are an extension of government, in my opinion. And it's difficult because PG and Pacific Power are not going to stand up for you folks. That's just not what's going to happen. They're guaranteed a rate of return. They are a legalized monopoly. They will testify in Oregon at the legislature on a bill that's going to increase your electricity rates. And they'll say, you know, this is might impact our ratepayers, but we know it's great for the planet. So we're supportive with a few minor tweaks. I would say ultimately you're going to have to leave PG and Pacific Power behind. And I think we can still make meaningful change without them. That's my answer to it.
So in 1 or 2 minutes, how does Agenda 21 and ICLEI have an effect?
Okay, 1 or 2 minutes, Agenda 21 and ICLEI. Agenda 21 and ICLEI are bad things, and you need to have someone else back here to talk an entire hour to you guys about that, and how it involves your life, and how it's about to restrict every aspect of your life.
Pretty good. Other question was franchise fees, attachments, piggybacking, new assessments for power lines everyone already paid for, and adding to the franchise fees. What's your thoughts about that? Are we looking at a new way to finance special projects?
Oh yeah, repeat questions. Are we looking at a new age of financing, new age of cost because of extensions of power lines and
Franchise assessments that we see now on our bills that weren't there 10 years ago?
I think you're going to see more of those. Those are the little add-ons on your bills when you see the adjustment sector and it sees a bunch of stuff and you're like, what is that, a credit or a debit? What is that thing? Yes, I think we're going to see those more. And I think why we're going to see those more, and I'm not sure exactly how this worked with utilities, but it's easier to get those put into it than versus like a general rate increase. So with PGE, they got a renewable resource cost adjustment written in there, and I think it was actually easier. So I think you're going to periodically see adjustments added to your bill that increase the cost of your bill. I like those a little bit better than general electricity rate increases, because at least you can call them up and say, hey, what the heck is this renewable cost increase? I didn't fill out that green power program. Take it off my bill and at least give them some trouble. But I do see more of them happening. One more maybe? Okay, let's do one more. Is there one more?
Working a campaign and also having worked a little bit for the Clean Coal Initiative myself, I discovered that they do not turn off the coal-fired power plants when the wind turbines are running. They achieve nothing for emissions reduction. Is there any reason you haven't included that little tidbit in your presentation?
You know what? This policy sector, I could go on for 6 hours, and I'm sure that they would love that. But you know what? That's a really interesting point, and I'll make it quick and then finish up. And I think that's a good one to leave it on. A lot of people don't understand how electricity is integrated into the grid system. And with inconsistent, unreliable energy sources, such as wind and solar, you have to balance those energy sources with other sources in order to make so you don't have brownouts like I saw in California, or power surges. It has to be in complete equilibrium. Right now in the Pacific Northwest, we generally use hydroelectric dams. So when the wind blows, we shut down another renewable energy source. And it creates problems as well. As we've seen in some of the articles, Bonneville Power Administration has to spill water over the dams. It caused issues with fish, environmentalists scream. But then again, environmentalists always scream, so it's not anything new. But with something like this, once we run out of the capacity for hydro, we're going to use spinning reserve, either coal or natural gas, to back up wind generation. What that means is we're going to use it as a less efficient rate than if it was running full out, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And many studies have shown that it actually increases the amount of emissions per energy created, balancing the power of wind. And that's unfortunate. I mean, when you're a green sky program or a green power program guy is trying to sell you on renewable energy, you can say, actually, even Bonneville Power Administration has admitted it to me, it's in publications, that it's actually going to increase the amount of emissions because of this balancing. So what do we get for it? We build two power plants for the energy of one. That's what we get. Thank you guys very much.